turned to the band, and wham!
He had all of America tapping their feet to his music.
You could not compare Sousa with any one person. Sousa did it as no one had done it before, and really as no one will ever do it since.
Our nation's first music superstar. If You Knew Sousa, tonight on The American Experience. Major funding for this series is provided by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by the financial support of viewers like you.
Corporate funding for The American Experience is provided by Aetna for more than 135 years, a part of The American Experience.
Good evening and welcome to The American Experience. I'm David McCullough. Once upon a time, Americans had a love affair with a portly little bandmaster named John Philip Sousa. His exuberance and patriotism, his joy in the possibilities of popular entertainment, his originality, were all exactly in step with the times. What Johann Strauss did for the waltz, Sousa did for the march, and his rousing music was as unmistakably American as the strains of Strauss were Viennese. In 1889, the year of Sousa's first big hit, his famous Washington Post March, the national mood was upbeat and expansive as Oklahoma Territory opened to settlement and a young American journalist named Nellie Bly circled the world in record time, just 72 days. By the 1890s, when the ever-productive Sousa was composing Hands Across the Sea, Liberty Bell, and the incomparable Stars and Stripes Forever, America had become the greatest industrial nation on earth. It was the time of the skyscraper, an all-new American innovation, of Thomas Edison, Admiral Dewey, and the rise of the irrepressible Theodore Roosevelt. Then, after 1900, with Roosevelt in the White House and a brand new century underway, it was as if the Sousa tempo and that of the nation were inseparable. Sousa marches, wrote a critic, are without doubt the most typical music which this country has yet produced, for they are deeply imbued with the American spirit. Sousa was the first of our composers to be taken seriously in Europe. He became a cultural export. And of course, his music is as alive today as ever. He remains a national treasure. But who was John Philip Sousa? What was it about his music that so captured the heart of the nation? That's the story that follows. If You Knew Sousa.
September 1892, John Philip Sousa introduced his new band at a concert in Plainfield, New Jersey, and then took his players on the road to prolonged and fabulous success. Sousa's band was a concert band. It almost never marched. At a Sousa concert, it was the audience that did the marching. Sousa pioneered the big road tour and made it pay. He took his band to every city and tank town where a railroad went. Each night he played his famous marches along with the music of Beethoven, Puccini, and Mendelssohn. He played Wagner's Parsifal in Grand Forks, North Dakota, 10 years before it was heard at the Metropolitan Opera House in New York. Sousa was America's first big-time musical superstar. His marches were the blockbuster hits of his day, and he became the best-known musician in the world, the March King. In real life, he was a quiet little man with a wry sense of humor and a genius for press agentry and showmanship. The people of America enjoyed a long and passionate love affair with band music, which climaxed just before World War I. Though the passions faded during the Depression, there are many who still live of the music of John Philip Sousa.
After that, I'll take bells. No. Hal, wait for a lot of applause. Wait for all that time. I'll turn around, give you the nod. Okay. That's the stuff.
It was here, at the Marine Barracks in Washington, that John Philip Sousa heard music for the first time. His father was a trombone player in the Marine Band. The elder Sousa was a Spanish sailor of Portuguese descent. He joined the Marine Band in 1850. He marched in Lincoln's inaugural. He traveled with the president to Gettysburg to dedicate the cemetery there. Young Philip Sousa, as he was known, was brought here in 1867 by his father and enlisted in the Marines as a musician's boy. He was 13 years old. Sousa lived and worked in this environment for 38 years.
United States Marine Band, all present or accounted for.
I was born on the 6th of November, 1854, on G Street Southeast, near the old Christ Church, Washington, D.C., and would say, had I the opportunity to be born again, I would select the same parents, the same city, and the same time. Was one of the loveliest men I ever knew. He was a scholar and a patriot. He knew everything except how to make a living. He used to say that the day was made for rest and the night for sleep, and he lived that with a consistency which few men attain in carrying out their ideals. Mother was a wonderful, fearless woman whose simple faith in goodness was eternally strong. She gave birth to 10 children and lived her life for them and for her husband. I suspect I was always her favorite.
As the son of a Marine Band musician, he undoubtedly could hear this music at almost any time of the day. And like all small boys, I think he was attracted to it. I see this with my own children, and I see it with kids when we play concerts. I think that this music, march music, has something which is attractive to young children, and it probably made a deep impression on him. And I think, as we all think about our own lives and the earliest memories, they are often some of the most profound and deep and meaningful things to us, or the things we remember from our youth. Smells, certain dishes that our mother might have cooked for us, or certain experiences that we had. And I think this was something which was deeply rooted in Sousa, whether he knew it or not, whether he realized it or not, or whether he made a cognitive decision about it or not. I think that this was part of his consciousness from the time he was a baby.
This is absolutely wonderful, this thing, as a boy violinist. Sousa himself has said of his debut as a virtuoso, "My first appearance in public was at the age of 11 when my teacher gave a concert at the United States Asylum for the Insane near Washington. This was his annual treat to the unfortunate inmates of the institution, and he had taken special care in teaching me a solo I was announced to play."
Yeah.
And that picture, that is just absolutely, that's just...
I'd like to know where the original of that is. Do you see how young he appears
sure,
here? Compare
sure.
with the picture on the wall here.
Boy, he must have been just about 26.
At 26, Sousa was appointed director of the Marine Band. His father persuaded the commandant that it would be a good idea. Sousa was the youngest ever to hold that position and the first to be born in America.
The end of his name is USA, and that's what he is, USA. And I love to go past his house where he was born. I've threatened someday to buy that house. And I so honored Sousa, I thought he was such a great American, that I went down to the Congressional Cemetery and bought myself a grave. So when I die, I'll be buried near 26 steps from John Philip Sousa's grave. And the Marines play there every year for his birthday. They go down there. So they'll be playing for me too.
Sousa directed the Marine Band for 12 years, served 5 presidents. His popularity in Washington was such that after he left the job, his successor was arrested and court-martialed for refusing to play a Sousa march.
I knew that he was absolutely fanatical about music because I would go to a movie with him, and instead of paying attention to what was happening in the movie, he was listening to the background music and singing the baritone part, and that didn't seem normal to me because other people didn't do that in the movies. He would take money that we didn't have to buy used Sousa records, and we never knew whether we were going to have enough food for the month, but he would, if he found a record, he had to have it.
I think the first time I heard Sousa, I was about 8 years old, and I heard the local high school band playing a march, and I thought, oh, wow, what was that? Our school closed down after I finished the fifth grade, no connection, and so I remembered that the school had an old wind-up Victrola that they played these marches that were written by this Sousa fella. So a bunch of us kids, we broke into the school one day, and I got as far as Victrola, and I don't know what the others did. All I know is that I was listening to the Stars and Stripes Forever over and over again, and then suddenly I looked up and I saw a cop, and he was standing there, what in the bleep are you doing here? I said, well, I'm listening to some good music. He said, well, why didn't you run like all those other kids?
I can't imagine Paul's life without Sousa. I just wouldn't... It just couldn't be.
This is a day-by-day log of Sousa's life. I start out with day one of his life and end up with an account of his funeral and burial.
He kept saying to me, Mr. Sousa had all of these interesting titles, King Cotton, the fairest of the fair, and he kept saying, well, who was the fairest of the fair? Somebody someday is going to write an article that's going to, or write a book that's going to tell me all these things. He kept saying that, and he kept waiting for that book to come out. Little did I dream that he was going to be the one who was going to do that.
Paul Byerly printed a business card asking for help in tracking down Sousa's work, which was scattered all over the country. He found the Sousa Band's library at a high school in Illinois. He found 60 trunks full of sheet music on the dirt floor of a Florida college basement. A man on Long Island had the band's encore books. He found 85 volumes of press clippings. And in the back corner of a cellar in the Sousa home on Long Island, he personally rescued more than 20,000 pieces of music in Sousa's own handwriting. He learned that Sousa had published 3 novels, an autobiography, hundreds of songs, suites, and waltzes, 15 light operas, and 136 marches. Along the way, Paul Byerly found a number of people who are just as passionate about Sousa as he is.
Let's see, we've got... Yeah, here. The dog fight, the... He goes through and revises. And he didn't even quite do it because he has a... And the later one, he's got them, boom, boom. And that was, well, maybe that's what he's doing. He's probably just notating the chords here, but he had the cornets hold that. You got more of the whole dogfight thing.
Yeah.
But, you know, that was, you don't see anything else. You don't see the tree.
Sousa was walking around in downtown Washington, D.C., and the two owners of the newspaper, the Washington Post, approached him, and they said, we're having this essay contest down on the Smithsonian grounds. Do you think it'd be possible for you to write one of your marches, you know, so we could have a special march, because this is going to be a real big deal? He said, sure, I'll write your march. So we went home and wrote the Washington Post march. The Marine Band played a little concert, and then the children read their essays, and then there was this featured march on the program, the Washington Post March. When the festivities were all over, the band marched up to the Willard Hotel, playing this new march, the Washington Post.
We think of these as marching pieces. But for many people, this was dance music, and a very basic kind of popular dance music. Not something for the stage or some highfalutin stuff. This was something that people would dance to at home.
There was a convention of dancing. And it got to the point was one of the first pieces recorded by the Marine Band with the Columbia Recording Studios here in Washington, one of the really first record companies in the whole United States, one of those old wax cylinders, a piece of beeswax is what it was. And they got the Marine Band to come down there, and they'd play into these horns all over the room, and they played the Washington Post March, and those sold very well. I mean, the company made money because they had the Washington Post and the ˈsuːsə marches on their recordings. The publishers got hold of it, and they scored it for everything. I mean, you have mandolin and piano, you have two zithers and piano, every possible instrumental combination for it. So everyone was playing it in their house. You could listen to it on the phonograph, you could hear it in the parade, you could dance to it in the dance hall. You know, if you're a zither player, you and your wife would sit down, she'd accompany you on the piano, and you'd play the zither or the mandolin.
Dr. Frank Simon told me, Simon was Sousa's solo cornetist for many years. He said when he was a child growing up in Middletown, Ohio, he said, I couldn't walk down a city block but what I didn't hear a Sousa march being played on a piano from one of the houses.
Sousa's band finally got to Europe. There was great concern, particularly when he got to Germany, because the German audiences were supposedly very strict, and they had the tradition of Brahms and of Beethoven, all this really heavy music. So Sousa took a lot of time to get the best programs possible. They were printed in German, and it was all the really high-powered overtures and big spiels from the Wagner operas and things like that. They got into one of the first halls, like in Berlin or one of these other towns, and they finished this huge Siegfried fantasy as the opening for this thing. A 15-minute work, a huge thing. And Sousa thought, oh, you know, he was really concerned about what the audience reaction was. And it was very good. I mean, they were very impressed with the band. And at that point, one of the people out in the audience stands up and he says, play the Washington Post. He went into the Washington Post. They played that as the encore. Then they did another piece, like Plantation Songs from the American Fields or something like that. And they played through it, and they had a lot of ragtime. The audience was like, yeah, they like that a lot. And another person, played the Washington Post. All right. They played it again. It ended up the whole program. They played the whole program of these heavy numbers and Washington Post as an encore to each piece. It was his ticket. I mean, we always talk about Stars and Stripes being the real big, you know, that his magnum opus. But the Washington Post opened more doors for Sousa than any piece he ever wrote.
Publisher Harry Coleman of Philadelphia paid Sousa $35 for the Washington Post, which included parts for band and orchestra. Coleman sold millions of copies and became rich, enough so that he bought two musical instrument companies. Nobody knows what Sousa did with the $35.
As I continued my research, I became acquainted with several of the Sousa men, and they would tell their old compatriots, here's this young fellow who's doing a book on the governor, and let's cooperate. And the name just came out of nowhere. You must visit so-and-so.
Was just 23 years old, and to me it was a wonderful thing happening to me. We started to play, and I thought, oh, this is wonderful. And that's how I felt all the way through until we got to the Stars and Stripes. They started to play Stars and Stripes, and it was so wonderful that I couldn't play. I started to forget what I was doing. I just couldn't play. I was so involved in the situation. There was Mr. Sousa conducting, and I'm playing in the band. It was wonderful.
In thickly populated states, we would play a matinee performance in one town and a night performance in another. And wherever there wasn't any regular trains to hook our cars on, why, they had special trains for us, special trains. I look upon him as a great man, a man who could attract people, and a lot of people came to see him as much as they did to hear him, hear his band, because he was an immaculate figure. He was a picture when he walked out on the stage. And there was no other attraction like that traveling in those days. His name had a touch of magic, and it still has.
He was the Beatles. He was you could not compare Sousa with any one person today, because you didn't have the media, and you did it in an entirely different way. But Sousa did it as no one had done it before, and really as no one will ever do it since, because the technology has changed. Sousa finally did it by the railroad. This local success is great. Appearing here and there is great. But this was new. Getting on the train, finding every town that could support a concert. Back and across the United States. That was a new idea. And that was the only way you could really become a media star. You didn't have television. You didn't have any way of transmitting. But you got on the train and you went everywhere.
Oh, did we move? I want to tell you. I used to carry in my cab my itinerary. We got a new itinerary for a week, telling you what time we arrived in the town, where the concert was, what time the matinee began. But I'd meet people on the tour, and they'd say, where did you play yesterday? And they know I'd have to think about it. We traveled so fast, I'd have to consult the itinerary. I forgot where I was yesterday. Now, that's how fast we went.
As a young director of the Marine Band, he saw the other guys making it. And he knew that if he could get free of this commitment to the President of the United States, he could have a very successful career. That's when he signed up with David Blakely, who was the manager of Patrick Gilmore. And this was a very shrewd move on Sousa's part. Of course, things fell into place beautifully for Sousa. First of all, the first year he went out with his own band, Patrick Gilmore died. Very convenient. It left the field wide open.
Sousa hired the best musicians Blakely's money could buy and rehearsed them without mercy, usually in three languages, German, Italian, and English, with some of his father's Spanish for emphasis. They played Sousa's difficult arrangements of Wagner, Rossini, and Grieg. Sousa's marches were offered to the audience like candy as a reward for applauding the serious numbers. Sousa earned four times his Marine salary plus 20% of the profits. Blakely found Sousa a new publisher for his marches on much better terms. And even though Blakely took 50% of the march royalties, Sousa now earned as much as $40,000 a year from just one march. At the Columbian Exposition in Chicago in 1893, Sousa played popular tunes along with the classics. But he found that medleys of old-time hymns were what won the hearts of the millions of Midwesterners who ventured from their small towns to the big fair.
The Columbian Exposition turned out to be his real launching pad. That's where he got his first sustained national attention as an independent bandmaster. The fair would have, on certain days, 200,000 or 300,000 people in the grounds. The largest day in Chicago, they had something like 700,000. I think you could imagine that this wonderful visual scene was complemented by the kinds of music that the Sousa Band played, which included hymns. And there was collective choral singing. The crowds would join in. The fact that people actually sang these hymns added to the intensity of the moment. And the fair was frequently described in a vocabulary that can only be called religious.
Even in my hometown, there were some old ladies that remembered when he came and talked about it. He had a valet. Always on tour. It was usually the man who held up the encore cards when they were playing, but he was also specifically Sousa's valet to get him ready for concerts, to make sure he looked just right. And he took half hour, 45 minutes, an hour sometimes to prepare, to make sure that he looked terrific. I mean, he had his uniforms were all specially made. There were no pockets because he had a bit of a pot belly, so no pockets so that they would bulge and valet would make sure his shoes were shined and his pants were pressed. He took a huge cabinet of fresh uniforms, and those were always kept, you know, really clean. And the band, which I think is an interesting point about the band, is nowadays you go into a concert
and the orchestra players sort of mingle on, and you have this sort of annoying, you know, blick, 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 and boom, 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 and all these noises, you know, they're sort of superfluous to what's going to happen. With Sousa's band, there was you got to the hall early, and you got your instrument out early, and you warmed up early. But once those doors were open and the crowd started coming in, there was no more playing. And no one went out on the stage. The stage was filled with chairs and with the stands, but the old gas lanterns are burning in the hall and the people are coming in. But no music, not a sound. And 5 minutes before or so, Mr. Russell, the librarian, would say, all on. And the musicians would come in single file from both sides, the winds on the, as you're looking at it, from the left and the brass from the right, filed in. They're beautiful, you know, black Sousa band uniforms. Their shoes are shined, their pants are pressed. They sit down, and they look at the music, because lots of times they were going to play something they'd never played before that night. I mean, the program could change at any time. They'd just peek through and see, look and point. And the old guys would say, watch out there. He's going to take it in 3/4. But no music. Sousa'd be waiting in the wings, and the minute the clock, you know, hit the time, that you'd hear the gas lamps, the hall would come down, and the gas lamps on the stage would light up, and Sousa would come out, and he walked very fast because his legs were short. So he'd come out almost striding to come out. He'd take one bow, turn to the band, and wham!
A real eighth. Don't play that way. Play with what you see, not with what you hear. Because then it comes in, you hear that. That's be very precise. Right here, letter E.
I heard the Sousa band when I was about, I imagine, 8, 9, 10, or 11, someplace. I can remember where I sat in the Bardavon Theater in Poughkeepsie, New York. I can't remember one thing about what I heard. I can't. I know that my father got me out of school because he and my mother went to the evening concert, and I can't remember. I can remember that I was there, and I wish I could remember more. It provokes me. I'd like people to say, oh, yes, I said he was this, he was that. I can't remember a thing. My father wrote the Sousa Band and tried to get me with the Sousa Band. He got a letter from Harry Askins. He says, Mr. Sousa does not use children in his band. I give my father A for effort. Yes, sir.
For many people, Sousa bridged a number of worlds. They could go to a Sousa concert, feel they were participating in something that was important and serious, yet also enjoyable. Sousa said, it's okay to enjoy popular music. You don't have to feel ashamed of it. When he began his career,
There were very few symphony orchestras in America, and I think there were probably many Americans who heard their first Beethoven or Wagner or Verdi at a band concert. The music was geared right to the center. It was not beyond the audience. There were some who felt, in fact, that it was pitched a little too low. There were Sousa critics who thought he played too much popular, show, vulgar music. But Sousa, I think, knew what his audience was there for, and they were there for pleasure.
Applause, applause. Get it ready, get it ready. Get it ready. Applause, applause, applause. So forth, so forth, so forth. Hey, a lot of applause, a lot of applause, a lot of applause. Okay, you, and I'll ask you to stand up. You're going to receive the applause. Take the bow, so forth, so forth, so forth. All right, now here we are. That's the way it's going to happen, so plan on that. We're going to play this number just as soon as I get you seated. So, patatatum.
Sousa would turn and bow, and he'd turn to the first clarinetist and he'd say, L cap. And the clarinets would say L cap to the saxophones, and the saxophones would say L cap to the tuba players, and the tuba players would say L cap to the trombone players, and the trombone players L cap to the cornet players. Well, by this time, Sousa's already three bars into the introduction of it. There was no time to hunt music. They had to memorize these things. It's great in the first cornet book of the encore books, it's just the introductions to about 10 of the favorite Sousa marches that they just keep right there. So while Herbert Clark is playing, yep, up, 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 Frank Simon's running like hell trying to find the part.
Bass drum, in looking at the music as it was written in Mr. Sousa's day, the stem down indicated bass drum being played with cymbals as one instrument. In other words, the player would hold the cymbal in the left hand and hit it on one that's fastened to the top of the drum. He'd hit the other one like this.
No one who has watched and heard Helmicky with my band will differ with me when I declare that my bass drummer has the spirit and soul of a great artist.
Bass drummer Gus Helmicky gave the band its heartbeat. He was Sousa's most valued and highest paid musician, a virtuoso who could play melodies on his drum.
In marches and things, he was able to do little things and put a little accents in where the boss would do something like that and Gus would give him a little accent. Sousa probably felt that it would sound good in there. And he could do it, but I don't think anyone else could do it. We had other bass drummers that would come in after Gus left, or when he was off. They did a good job, but there was no rapport there, like, between Sousa and Gus.
Sousa wrote El Capitan as a song to be sung in the third act of one of his most popular operas. As he did with many of his opera tunes, he arranged it into a march. It became the big hit of 1896. When Admiral Dewey sailed into Manila Bay during the Spanish-American War, the band on deck was playing El Capitan.
Thank you.
I was just a kid, about 12, and not quite 12. Sousa Band was playing at the State Fair in Springfield, and my dad took me. My dad was a lover of band music, and that one concert literally changed my whole life. I really couldn't sleep. I heard that beautiful band, and I made my dad take me again. Was it really that good? And I'm not dreaming. It's the greatest sound I ever heard from any band. It wasn't just the men in the band either. It was Mr. Sousa. I remember in Joliet, this would be about 1922, Sousa Band came to Joliet and played a concert. They got off the train at 7:15 in the morning. Now, normally, there'd been some other ensemble. There wouldn't be anybody down there. We're 5,000 people at the station. The streets on Joliet Street were three blocks lined up. And what do you think happened? The Sousa Band, they didn't play. They paraded down the street for two or three blocks, not a long one, to the hotel, really. And they came down the street, and Sousa was in a big white Cadillac sitting up in the back, you know. And, of course, the radio men were all Sousa. And people, yeah, he hasn't made a downbeat yet. I mean, they haven't heard the concert.
And repeat. Don't think of putt-putt. I'm a violinist. I would use my entire bow. Rum, bam, beep, bump. Not putt-putt. Here we go. Bum, make those tones ring. It's a full chord, incidentally. Make that chord ring out. Here we go. More.
He was a very difficult man, and particularly with solos. Well, Mr. Pryor told me this, Arthur Pryor in my own home told me this, that he was to play a solo in Cork, Ireland. And he came out on the stage, and his shoelace was not tied. And Sousa came down and saw this. And Sousa said, follow me. He left the stage. And when they got in the wings, he said to Pryor, tie your shoelace. You're a soloist with the Sousa Band.
More. And hold it. Now, push. Kick it again.
Some people think I'm tough. Well, I'm demanding, yes. But if tough means you want it right, then I'm tough. I'm uncompromising. I'm a totally dedicated to perfection. And when it's just about right, I'm unhappy. To me, that's like a pilot that misses the runway by 8 feet. I mean, you know, you're dead. He's almost right.
That's right. Now the flutes. Thank you. Flutes. Allegro. The droning open fifth. G and a D on the trumpet. Good.
He didn't play claptrap. Take a look. There isn't a piece of junk in the whole program. Oh, smart enough to know that the audience that attends the Sousa Band concerts is not the same audience that goes to the Metropolitan. He knew that. He played to the common man. And he, by doing that, didn't only attract the common man, he attracted the sophisticated because it was quality. And even the most sophisticated critic could go and say, this is music. He has it all. You're talking about, there's mind music. I'm talking about pop, so on. Mind music. There's heart music. There's foot music. And you, when you build a program, you reach all those sources.
You paid your 75 cents to get your regular ticket in the hall, and you get your program. This one here. And for an extra 10 cents, you could get the nice Sousa Band, official Sousa Band souvenir program. Sousa would commission Polestar to do a cover on it. And here's your official Sousa picture, suitable for framing. All this was good. And here's a picture of Sousa on his horse, you know, Sousa as sportsman. It's good stuff. I mean, you know, in my state, in Iowa, people eat that up, you know. Guy rides a horse, shoots a gun. Boxers, and his friends were trap shooters. His friends were horsemen.
He was one of the finest trap shooters in the United States, and he was a fellow that could knock out 100 birds without missing one. He loved a horse, a rod, and a gun, and he was a real he-man.
He was very much aware of the need to overcome this prejudice of American males, I think, in particular, the fear that they would be branded as effeminate or sissies if they went in for concert music. The Sousa concert gave you the best of both possible worlds. It gave you the macho image and it gave you the music at the same time. There's a publicity shot taken of him in younger years with boxing gloves. He wanted people to know that he was underneath all of that, there was still a man.
On the 22nd of February, 1879, I was introduced to the loveliest girl I had ever seen, Jenny Bellis of Philadelphia. She had a cloud of chestnut hair and a perfect complexion. She was wearing a little gray bonnet and was charmingly dressed. I liked everything about her. Her manner, her speech, her voice. We married before her 17th birthday rolled around. Mrs. Sousa realized that my life work was to be music. That music was an exacting mistress, and that domestic affairs would have to be subordinated to the musical demands of the moment. She was therefore careful never to interrupt my train of thought or disturb me at my work. She always had the kindliest words for my achievements because of her incurable belief that I can do it better than anybody else.
The Sousas had three children. John Philip Jr., born in 1881, went on to play baseball for Princeton. His father brought him in as a ringer for the Sousa baseball team. It's no surprise that Sousa himself was the pitcher. Press releases assure us he was outstanding. There were two daughters, Jane Priscilla and Helen. In 1966, Helen was interviewed for a radio program.
If Father wanted something done, he'd take a whack at it himself. And he was not what the Spanish call muy hábil, handy. And so there was always a constant feud about Mother's manicure scissors, which she selected with the greatest care, and then Father would use them to hope get a cork out of a bottle. There was a small library off the living room down the Sands Point house, and Father would go in there and sit down and score something. And there could be 20 or 25 people in the living room talking at the top of their lungs. Didn't bother him the least, had terrific concentration. But if they started to sing anything or play anything, you'd hear them say, hey, 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 hey. And that had to stop.
There was a story that one of the soprano soloists talked about riding on the train one night. They were going through the western part of the country, and it's real cold outside, and the moon's kind of showing, the train's just chugging along. She was sitting in the car with Sousa, in the they call it the Royal Suite, where Sousa and the soloist could sit and relax. And he kept them away from the bandsmen. He didn't want them to even talk to them. And she said he was just sitting there smoking his cigar, and she was sort of watching him and reading him at the same time. And he pulled out his little manuscript book and just started sketching and took his cigar out and put it in the ashtray and doing all this. And she started watching him really intensely and going along, sketching out this march that turned out to be the Invincible Eagle. She sat there and watched Sousa compose the Invincible Eagle. And she said it was almost like when he was done with this sketch that he put his violin back in his case and folded it up, put his little book back in his pocket, stuck his cigar back into his mouth, and looked out the window. He says, "My goodness, ma'am, it's a really dark night out tonight." That's all he said.
Well, he was a complete introvert, and he spoke very, very quietly, and he had a curious little Baltimore accent, you know. It was a kind of a, I remember he said Gero. It was a curious way they say their R's in Baltimore. I can't imitate it, but he was a good in-demand luncheon speaker and so on, and he told dry little stories.
In 1921, a nervous boy from Mason City, Iowa, joined the Sousa Band and was quickly acclaimed as a flute virtuoso. He later went on to the New York Philharmonic and then a career as a composer and radio comedian. But his heart remained at home with the small town band. In 1954, he wrote The Music Man. His name, Meredith Wilson.
We used to visit on the train, you know, where the little three-car train, and always you left at 6 o'clock in the morning, and sometimes you play a matinee in Butte and a night in Wyoming and Cheyenne, and you made big jumps. But he would visit, you know, on the train one day. He said, you must never be falsely modest. He said, I note that you're studying score. You want to be a conductor someday? I said, I hope so. Composer, positive composer, you're fine. He said, if you achieve this, he said, never be falsely modest. Because he said, get you no place. He says, for example, I write the most popular marches in the world today. And I said, oh, of course, Mr. Sousa. He says, why are they the most popular? I said, well, because they're the best. He said, well, they are, but that's not a good answer. He said, they're the best because I write for the military band, like Beethoven wrote for the symphony orchestra. I conceive it for the instruments and the sections in the band as Beethoven conceived it for the... He said, you know how Semper Fidelis goes? I said, well, certainly. It goes, he says, I'll show you how it goes. He says, I'm talking about the trumpet solo. Pa-pee, ba-ba-bum, ba-ba-ba, ba-ba-bum-ba-bum. And he says, what happens then? I said, well, then comes the drums. They've got the big drums. He says, I'll show you. What happens then? I said, well, then comes the bass, the basses, and it goes like, he says, I'll show you how they go. He says, now what happens? You ought to know. If you don't know, you're fired. I said, I do know. It's the woodwinds. And it goes like in the piccolos and the flutes. And it goes like this. He says, I'll show you. I'll go. He says, then comes the counter melody with the dominant strain with the trombones all down on the front. He says, if you don't stand up and march, then you never will.
I keep reminding people that Sousa's teacher was a student of Brahms, that he had an enormous training in European music, even though he never left Washington. He was an arranger for Offenbach when he was in his 20s, when Offenbach came to the United States, that he was a successful arranger of Gilbert and Sullivan's operettas in the United States, and Sullivan remarked at what a great orchestrator he was again when he was in his 20s. He traveled Europe widely, he had perfect pitch, he remembered performances of all the great masters that he heard live himself in Europe and brought those ideas back to the United States. This is a musician of extraordinary sophistication. Was inducted into the Shriners in the Alma Temple in Washington and wrote this march for them in the 1920s and performed it with a band of 6,200 Shriners along with the Sousa Band.
A march must be as free from padding as a marble statue. Every line must be carved with unerring skill. There's no form of musical composition where the harmonic structure must be more clean cut.
Incredible. He do something in this in ink and never have to make a change.
No correction. Well, here he pencils in just a little bit of what he's going to do for a counter melody.
Uh-huh.
It is a measure of inspiration. Anybody can write music of a sort, but touching the public heart is quite another thing. My religion lies in my composition.
Almost every Sousa march has one of these breakup strains, and they're lots of fun. In this case, I think Sousa possibly was thinking about the premiere in Griffith Stadium where there would be all these Shriner bands to play along, because he writes a gigantic trumpet fanfare.
It is not a nonchalant morning's work. I often dig for my themes. I practice a sort of self-hypnotism by penetrating the inner chambers of my brain and receiving the themes. Sincere composers believe in God. Thank you.
Major funding for this series is provided by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by the financial support of viewers like you.
Corporate funding for the American Experience is provided by Aetna for more than 135 years, a part of the American Experience. By the 1920s, Sousa was an old established American institution. Fans from his early years were now bringing their grandchildren to hear him. He never lost his phenomenal rapport with his audience. He knew what they loved, and he gave it to them. In 1922, he wrote a humoresque based on Gershwin's hit song, Swanee. More and more, Sousa was sharing the stage with movies and vaudeville. In Atlantic City, he'd always been a big attraction at the Steel Pier. But now, so were Rin Tin Tin, Singer's Midgets, and a horse that dived off a tower into a pool.
Well, they are Singer Midgets. The operator, his name was Singer. And he took these little people on the road, Singer's Midgets, and they were on the pier. Some of the boys from Hawaii are there, the high divers. A lot of big shots down here in the movie business, but I can't remember the names except Rin Tin Tin. I'll tell you one thing about this. The boss was mad as hell about having to have this picture taken. He didn't like it. The trouble was, if he could have come down and had his picture taken right away, but what he had to do was wait around till the photographer got everything all set, and that was quite a while.
Yeah.
And he got madder and madder.
Sousa spent an extraordinary amount of time posing for the photographer. Though he seldom seems to have enjoyed it, he did everything he could to get his picture in the papers. For 40 years, he orchestrated the press with the same finesse that he applied to his music. The popularity of jazz and good time dancing that emerged from the war years and took hold during the 20s worried Sousa. His band was making more money than ever, and his personal popularity was at an all-time high. But he could see that the time of the big concert band was past its peak. Instead of going to a concert, more and more young people were going out to dance.
From Monday on, my cares are over. From Monday on, I'll be in the
jazz is as much a part of American life as attention-compelling advertising and high-pressure salesmanship. Nowadays, the most soap is sold not by the maker of the best soap, but by the soap maker who attracts the most attention with his advertising. Just now, it is the style to be crazy. This is an age of speed, raw, racket, and here is the basic reason for jazz. The rhythm attracts, and by its constant repetition, holds attention. This afternoon, we'll jazz Paderewski's Minuet. I don't know how Paderewski would like it, but the people approve. They like the rhythm.
This is John Philip Sousa, and I'm very glad to be here with my band, representing my own country, America, on this international program. I've been asked to begin with a march that is an old favorite of mine. Maybe you will recognize it.
It took a significant fee to bring John Philip Sousa to the radio microphone in 1929. He hated radio, and he hated the phonograph even more. Sousa coined the phrase, canned music. For him, performing before an audience was the only way. Though he was well into his 70s, he insisted on maintaining the grueling schedule of the road tours of those who had started the Sousa Band in 1892. He was the only one still at it.
He broke his neck in the early 20s. His horse threw him and he broke his neck. And it hurt him to move. It hurt him to walk. There were times after concerts, he'd ask one of the guys on the train, he'd say, can you help me with my coat? He says, I can't get it off. He couldn't get his jacket off. It hurt him so much. There are times he'd go off stage in intermission, and he'd be drenching with perspiration. He was just conducting like this, but it hurt him so bad. I mean, he could have retired and lived the rest of his life as a millionaire, sat on his laurels. I mean, he'd still been the March King, but he didn't.
We consider it a great honor and a pleasure to have you conduct your own organization, the United States Marine Band, in the playing of your new march, the Royal Welsh Fusilier.
Thank you very much.
He said that last year of his life, he wished he could live to be 100 so he could write more marches.
Yeah.
And that last year alone, he wrote 7 of them, and all of them are just as vibrant mm-hmm. and wonderful as anything he wrote when he was 25.
The last concert we played was on the end of the pier. I don't think any of us realized it was absolutely the last concert. I'll tell you, I had a sneaking feeling that that was it. But there's no way that you could point to something in the program and say, well, that's it. And he drops the baton and walks off just the same without any. There was no indication that we were at a point where finished.
He died. There was no. Sousa used to tell the papers, when you hear of Sousa retiring, you'll hear of Sousa dead. And that's exactly what happened. He went to Reading, Pennsylvania to conduct the Reading Municipal Band and went through the program, and the final piece he conducted was The Stars and Stripes Forever. Went to a little banquet and went back to his hotel and died. That was it.
Well, he visited with the Theodore Presser home, which was a retired home for musicians in Philadelphia, and then he had lunch in the Penn Athletic Club in Reading. Then in the afternoon, he took a nap, and then he bought some cough syrup. And that evening, he rehearsed with the Ringgold Band. Then early that morning, his secretary, who was in an adjoining room, heard him coughing. She summoned a doctor, and by the time the doctor got there, he was gone.
My mother come up and shook me in the bed. She said, Johnny, what? She says, your boss just died.
This one photo here is the last photo of Sousa.
This is the last one that was ever taken of Sousa.
And when Sousa died, my father didn't want to live. No matter how you talk to him, whatever, he just... nothing in his life meant anything to him anymore. And he just... that was his whole life.
I don't think really I realized until my father died how great he was. I think it was seeing the people lining up the streets in Washington as the caisson rolled toward the cemetery and saw these women weeping. They'd lost a friend somehow.
They go out to the Congressional Cemetery, have a firing squad, and play taps, and that was the end of an era.
Thing for him in the whole world. That's Sousa loved people, and that's why they made him their king, their march king. But he never forgot about anyone, and that means a lot to me. Kind of a poor farm kid from Iowa sort of stuff. I mean, he's my hero.
Hearing this now over the mic, cornets and trumpets, I want you to understand this, trombones, this is very important. You come out, you hold your instrument like this till I give you a... when you hear that, your instrument goes up and we play it, but it's very important that it's done in the utmost of precision, accuracy, the details, so that when they see, they, oh, isn't that wonderful? Let's take this once again, if you will, at 150, that's a good spot.
That composition is known the world over as the Stars and Stripes Forever.
I've told my band, I said, everybody has to have heard the Stars and Stripes Forever for a first time, just as you, just as I. They get the message. In other words, you play to the top level of your efficiency, because somebody's going to hear it the first time.
I talked to so many of the Sousa people, and one of the questions I always asked them was, do you ever get tired of playing the Stars and Stripes Forever? I mean, you played it thousands of times. I mean, you played it morning and afternoon, everywhere you went, you know, for months and months on end. And these people looked at me as if I'm crazy. You think we get tired of playing the Stars and Stripes Forever? We're standing there, we're playing with the immortals. Here is the man called March King. They looked out into the audience and they saw the reaction of the people. Sometimes there'd be tears in their eyes. They had the music memorized. They didn't look at the music. They watched the people. No, they didn't get tired of playing the Stars and Stripes Forever. Sections going out to play. I enjoyed the piccolos.
You can play Stars and Stripes Forever.
Forever.
Forever. And they, I remember places where they stood up when it was being played, the same as they would with the Star Spangled Banner. They stood up.
Thank you.
nobody was let down. He was really Santa Claus. If you want to know who he was, maybe we don't know who Santa Claus was anymore. He was, and he delivered every time.
Channel 17 report, next on Channel 17, and at 3:30, Sesame Street. ¶¶